thank you for the introduction. When our technical assistant brought this, I thought, this is going to be interesting. No place to hang this mic today, but I'll carry it anyway. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity, Prof. Kalaus. I don't know if I pronounce it correctly. He sent me an email and asked me to present a lecture here, and I thought, he made a mistake. He sent it to the wrong person, and I ignored the email. And I got a very sweet reminder that I should urgently answer him, otherwise I'm going to be in big trouble. So then I realized this was really, he was honest in this invitation. So thank you for the opportunity. Today I want to talk about mobile applications. All of us are using mobile applications, but more specifically, I'm a software engineer. Unfortunately, a positive by heart, but I also do qualitative research. So my work is more in the field of system development methodologies. And I have a question here today. Maybe you can help me answer it in the end. Is when we think about mobile applications, it's really small software programs. Should we bother with system development methodologies? And I'll try to answer this question today. Okay, first of all, I want to show you where I came from. I'm from South Africa. If you look here, this is a map of South Africa. There you see the little star. That's the Vredefort Dome. This is actually a World Heritage Site. It's a spot where a meteorite connected with the Earth many millions of years ago. And you will see just opposite that little star is Potchefstroom. So we are famous for two things. We are near this Vredefort Dome. I'll show you a picture of it. This maybe it will interest you. There's a spot that shows that connection where the meteorite hit the Earth. And then also a little bit closer, it's very pretty if you drive through that area. You will see there's this concentric circles of little hills and water and the river, so it's really beautiful. So that's our one point of fame. The other one is, I don't know, are there anybody here from Spain? Nobody. That's so disappointing. The reason I say this, in 2010, you remember the Soccer World Cup was hosted in South Africa. Spain won. And the only reason they won is because we hosted them in Potchefstroom. So that's our second claim to fame. Okay, so I think we were so over the moon when they won, even more glad than the people in Spain anyway. So just a short overview of my presentation, the little introduction, then I will state our research problem. And then I'll speak a little bit about user acceptance of mobile applications. We will discuss a study which we performed on the use and effectiveness of STMs in mobile application development. And another study, it's actually a combination of three studies that we did, which I combine here today. I'm putting the pieces of the puzzle together today. So the last study was, we want to rank the use of STMs against other success factors when you develop mobile applications, and then we will come to a conclusion. Okay, let me continue on first of all with the introduction. With the increase of the adoption of mobile devices, we also saw the increase in the demand for mobile applications, and it has become a major part of everybody's life. Now, can I ask you, do you have your mobile phones with you? All of you, can you count the number of apps on your phones? Anybody? You seem stunned that I asked this. Oh, well, how many apps do you have on your phones? Guess? Five. Nobody more than 10? 25? 45. Okay, there's a can of soda there at the back, the lucky winner. The highest number of apps can get that can of soda. Let's see. 50. Do I have 50? 60. More than 60. Let's see. There are more than 60. Sir, how many do you have? 79. You are truly a man of your time. Okay, so congratulations to you. This little incident is just to show you that all of us are using mobile applications. Now, what is a mobile application? As I indicated there, it's just a little piece of software applications working on our phones that help us to have access to information anywhere, anytime. You've seen this a number of times, I suppose, but you can classify mobile applications in five categories. The first one there is the transactional one. I want to describe this in terms of Disney World. Say, for example, you want to visit Disney World and you want to buy a ticket to go to the Magical Kingdom, for example. Then you can use your mobile phone to buy the ticket. And also, when you are at Magical World and you want to order an Uber driver to take you to Epcot, you are using this type of app. It's a transactional app where you do a commercial transaction and you can track and trace, for example, what is happening in a certain application. Then we have the content dissemination here, that type of app. Now you are at the Magical Kingdom and you want to meet Pocahontas, or you want to see a show of Pocahontas, whatever. You can go and on an app ask for information about the show. You ask for certain content. So that's the second type of app that you have. Social networking, after you've met Pocahontas, you take a picture and you post it all over Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. That's your third type. Personal productivity, after you spent the whole day at Magical City, you are now bound, scheduled, and then you can use certain apps to help you to increase your personal productivity. For example, to schedule tasks because you've missed a day, now you have to rearrange your agenda and stuff like that. And then the last one is leisure. Leisure, I must say, does not include any social exchanges. We don't mean, am I in front of you here? We don't mean anything like Facebook or Twitter, that kind of stuff. Here we are talking about games, mobile games you play. I don't know if many of you are playing mobile games. I feel like generation dinosaur because I don't like to play games on my phone. Okay, so this is just the different types of or categories of mobile applications that we can have. And I must say, my students came to me, some of my students, you know, young people, Generation Z, they want to make money. And they told me, Prof, please help us. We want to write apps. People tell us you can write a $1 million app and you can become rich overnight. Help us. How should we do this? And I said, oh, okay, I don't know, I'm Generation Dinosaur. So we should try and get to the answer of this. And that is where this whole process started. And we have these three studies which were interlinked. So it was, you remember Pokemon Go? People didn't care about traffic or anything. They just went for that treasure to catch Pokemon. If you look at Pokemon Go and the Clash of Clans, during their height, during their peak seasons, if you look at these numbers, it's just amazing. 6 million for Pokemon Go and 10 million a day for Clash of Clans. That's a lot of money. If you look at this, you say, why didn't I think about it? You know, so, but sorry, that's already done. When you look at that successful applications, we only see that, but we forgot that there's numerous other applications that failed, but we never hear about that. We only hear about the successful applications. And my students coming to me and asking me to help them to become millionaires, we did a little research. We said, okay, there's a study done by App Promo in 2012, and they found that 80% of the mobile application developers are not generating sufficient revenue to support a standalone mobile application development business. Now, you can think about the enthusiasm. It was a little bit lower when I told them this. Then I said 59% are not even earning enough money to break even with the development cost. Down goes the enthusiasm. And the last one, 68% reported that their total revenue at the time of the survey was $5,000 or less. Now, you can imagine the faces of the students when they saw the statistics, but it gave me a lovely opportunity to ask them to do research. I didn't need to convince them in any way, to tell them, let's do research on this topic, and maybe if we have the answers, you can also become part of the success stories. Okay. So that led us to the research question, what factors influence the success of mobile applications, and will the use of SDMs, sorry, we use the acronym SDM for system development methodologies, will the use of SDMs influence the success of mobile applications? Now, what we decided with this investigations that we did, we should really focus on two of the most important stakeholders. Normally, when you are a software engineer, you are more technically orientated, and we are more worried about the development of the software as such. But we should remember we are developing something for people to use. So we need to follow a social, technical approach. We can't just look at the technical aspects and forget about the user outside. So that's what we did. We have this really strong focus on two of the major key holders. The first group was the users of the mobile applications. So we did a study on the user acceptance of mobile applications. When I get to that later, you can maybe test your own situation against the mobile apps that you've adopted and are using. Then the second group was the developers of mobile applications. What is the development process that they follow? Is it a sound, rigorous process? Sorry, we are focusing on the rigor. And that was the second group that we used there. Okay, so the first study, let's start off then with the first study with the user acceptance of mobile applications. I have a few references here which you can use. User acceptance, it's normally, they say it's extremely important, and this is from this paper by Godot and Johansson. They say it is extremely important for the success of mobile applications, but, it's always a but it's very difficult to predict. You don't know, how do you predict it? And it's also, in some ways today, still a mystery. It's a mystery, why? So, to start off with this, in 2016, the first study that we did is we started off looking at this user acceptance. And where do you start? You start with a literature review. Try and find everything you could on these factors that will influence user acceptance. So what we did, we made a list, first of all, that might influence user acceptance. It was, in the end, I think we had a list of 58 factors that we compiled. So we started off with the literature review, and then we were scared that we might forgot something, or that we missed something, or that the Generation Z people have some new stuff that hasn't been reported in the literature. So we did 20 interviews. That was fun, to talk to people about why they are using certain applications. We really did a great effort to include all types of users. Our oldest participant was 85, and our youngest participant was 8. So we spoke to them and we asked them, why do you like it? What is it that make you use this application? And then afterwards, we followed the whole qualitative analysis process. We identified factors that wasn't included in the literature, and we included then that updated list. We included in a survey And you'll see what we did there, that survey was performed in September 2016. We really did a lot of work. You can see we sent out 3,500 emails and we only got back 227. That's a 6.5 response rate. But unfortunately, that's the game we play. If you use electronic surveys, that's the kind of response that you get. So we were happy in the end, taking into account that that's what normally happens. So we had that 227 completed questionnaires, and we started to analyze the data. As this study I'm reporting here, I'm only reporting a small section of the study. I'm not reporting everything, so just keep that in mind. So what we have there, you will see there the 58 attributes that we identified. We performed factor analysis on that because 58 factors were too much to work with. And we were able to reduce the number of data to 11 factors and 17 attributes. I didn't load, and it was so important we treated them separately. I want to show you the results here. Maybe you can now start comparing with your own situation. In the first column there, you can see that's, I say, a factor or an attribute, and then in brackets it's the Cronbach alpha. The Cronbach alpha is just to indicate the reliability of a factor. So if it was a factor, remember I said there were 11 factors and a number of items that were kept alone. So then you will see something in brackets there. That was the Cronbach alpha to indicate the reliability of the factor that we formed. The first one there, for example, is problems with the app. I'll explain it now, but you see I use a red here. Red indicates that's a factor that is negatively contributing to the user acceptance of mobile applications. And then the items included there was things like this. It's slow, there's a lot of bugs, it affects the rest of the phone, poor design, unpredictable, and so forth. Then in the third column here is the mean. I'm only reporting the mean today. We use the Likert scale of 1 to 4 to measure their perceptions. And you can see if you have a 3.6 there out of 4, it's really good. It means that they feel that it's very important. The SD, it's for the standard deviation. You'll see there's not that much deviation, which is good. It means that the people really feel the same way. What I did here, I organized all these factors from the most important one to the least important one. I couldn't get it onto one table. But I'll show you the first 10, the most important 10, and we can discuss it. The first thing that accepts the most important attribute that influences user acceptance of mobile applications is problems with the app. And that's quality. If you want to put it into theoretical terms, it's about the quality of the app that was developed. So normally when we think about stuff, we think about things like it should be fun, it should be colorful, it should make you feel happy, stuff like that. But if there's problems with the app, people are going to dismiss it immediately and not going to use it any further. And then the second one, also negative, advertisements. Users hate advertisements when they are using mobile applications. So maybe it's time that we start rethinking our way of marketing our apps and our way of making money with the apps. So then you get a portability and mobility, number 3. Also, you can see the score there is still really high, 3.58. So that's very important to the users. Clarity was a very interesting one. We didn't expect it to rank so high. Clarity means if you promise me something, you should deliver it. Okay, it should be clear, true to what your title is. If you give a title to an app, that title should really reflect what is going to happen in that app. Don't come with surprises, and don't promise, overpromise, and you don't deliver something. So that clarity was important. Security, very important to the users. We had things like, they call it scaly permissions. Scaly permissions to get access to your photos or your address book or whatever, or a breach of security and privacy. That was very important. The next one, speed of tasks. This is a normal task that you perform to help you to speed up the task. Productivity. What they meant there was productivity means it should help you to do your job. Any app that can help you to do your job, for example, your calendar app that you are using, it's something that you can see here. Then user-friendly, that wasn't a surprise. User-friendly, ease of use, and then resource usage, also not a surprise for us that it's in the top 10. You don't want your battery to go flat in 5 minutes, stuff like that. Okay, so that was the top 10. I think it will be boring for you if I show the middle section. Maybe I can just quickly go through that. That's the middle section that we have there. Comfort, convenience, explanation, in line with my interests, too many updates, offline usage, cost. Yeah, I'm going to joke with our girls. Cost. It was, we did numerous other analysis, but women cared a lot about the cost. Men, no, this is one of the boys' toys. They buy it and it can cost whatever it costs. But our women, we are very careful about the cost. Then, goal-driven, it should be comprehensive and user-centered. Then, I don't know, maybe you should just sell it and not make it a free app, because advertisements is normally a problem if you have it as a free app that you can download. And then it's a way to get money from your platform that you are using. So if you can have it and you can sell it, people pay a little bit of money up front, say example $1, and they don't see all that advertisements, maybe that could be a way to help. But maybe you have a better suggestion. Remember Generation Dinosaur? I don't know. You should come up and help me here with this. Okay. I want to spend some time on the bottom 10 of the list. Those two factors marked in pink is factors that didn't matter. You see, it was on a scale from 1 to 4, so the average there would be 2.5, so anything less than 2.5 didn't matter to the users. I thought it was some calculation mistake, and we redid the stats, and it came out the same. Fun! I thought fun was this thing for mobile apps. No, and it should be popular. Everybody's using it now, I should be using it also. No, not a way, not a chance. So those two didn't feature in any way. The bottom list one here, I want to talk about this learning curve. The learning curve, we thought that it would be a problem for people if it took long to get to know an app. No, it's important, but not that important. And once again, ladies, we don't like to have difficult times learning an app. The men didn't worry about the learning curve. Okay, they were okay with this. It's the ladies that say, no, I don't want to spend too much time trying to figure out what is happening here. Okay, so I'm just going to leave it at this stage, leave it here. This is the list of factors that we identified, and I showed you the bottom 10, and this is then I showed you the top 10, and this is then the bottom 10. So maybe you can relate to that. This is the only part of the study that I'm going to show you. I want to move on to the next part of the study. How much time do I have? Oh, wow, okay. let's continue. The use and the second study we did focused on the use and effectiveness of STMs. Now, if the STMs, normally we would say, what is mobile application development? It's just that software engineering process that we follow to develop the apps. In order to produce high quality mobile apps, we need a suitable STM. The track record of a STM is the following. It does improve the quality of the product, and it does improve the development process if we use it in the correct context. Why am I worried about the STM for mobile apps? I'm not a representative for STMs. In my consulting work that I do, there are many cases which I will tell my clients, don't use a STM. It's not necessary. You don't need it. In complex situations, it's normally good for us to use a system development methodology. So for a mobile app, normally it's a small piece of software. Should we then really need a STM? So I ask myself this question. When you look at the track record of STMs, there are really advantages if you do use it. So we were worried. We thought, do people use it? And if they use it, does it help in any way? So this is a quick definition of a STM. All I can tell you, a STM, normally it consists of different aspects. You have your philosophical approach. Your philosophical approach is what was in the back of your mind when you developed that STM. Methods is the steps you take. The process model is the order of the steps you take, and the tools and techniques that will assist you. Normally, we classify STMs based on their philosophical approach. I'm going to choose one, for example. When you look at rapid development, what is the philosophical approach? It's speed. Okay. What would be the methods that you use? The methods that you use in the case of XP, for example, there's 12 practices which you use, and you use that in an iterative and incremental way. Right, so you normally classify your system development methodologies on that philosophical approach. Now you can see there's no classification here for mobile application development. So what now? We investigated a little bit further and we found that there are some STMs available for mobile app development. And if you look at them, I just mentioned a few here: MobileD, Masam, GMI, Modatel, and Mansurov's methodology. If you categorize them, you will see these two, MobileD and Masam, they are agile approach. GMI focus on the technical, physical performance of the mobile phone, and Modatel and Mansurov is object orientated. But we are not sure whether or not the developers are using it. So we did a study. Once again, in my heart, I'm a positive fist, so I mentioned all these things here to convince you that my research was very rigorously performed. Okay, so let's look at the results. What we found is that indeed the system developers or the mobile app developers are indeed using system development methodologies. But what a surprise! Look at the first one. Most popular one, it was the traditional system development life cycle. Why in the world? And I think I'm generation dinosaur. I should talk to that developer. The traditional system development life cycle, and it was in most of the cases people used it. Then if you look at the others, they mentioned XP, Roop, MobileD, Mansurov, Masam, Agile System Development Methodologies, and Scrum. We classified those. You will see there's a combination. There's Agile. Some of them, Roop is also traditional. Mobile, and Agile. So it seems, if we can summarize, the developers are indeed using methodologies. It's a combination, traditional and Agile, and then the mobile development methodologies. When we ask them about some aspects of the use, you will see we ask them, do you feel there should be a STM available? They were convinced, but on a scale of 1 to 10, that's not very, very enthusiastic. So they feel there should be a STM available. But when we ask them, do you need a STM during app development? Also not a very high rating there. We ask them, how strictly do you use an STM? Not that high. But what was the success of your mobile apps? Once again, I feel the people were not really convinced about the success of the apps that they developed. 7.75 is on average is not very high for the success. When you look at the time frame, 7.4, and for the budget even less. So it seems to me there's still something missing. They are looking for something to just take them to the excellent level when they develop this. We did a regression analysis, a Pearson correlation analysis, just to see if there's any relationship between the success of the mobile app and the strictness of use. So you'll see here, this was the success variable on this side, success of the mobile app, and were there any correlations between strictness of use of STM and time of use, and only strictness of use were at a medium correlation. The same for, if you look here, the mobile application delivered on time, it was also strictness of use that had an influence. None of them had an influence on the budget, and then the total success factor, we organized this also in a factor. The factor analysis indicated that we can make one factor, and once again, we got strictness of a STM there, had an influence on the total success. So it seems to us that if they use a system development methodology and they use it strictly, there is a positive aspect then. Then this is the last part of the third study that we performed. So now we know what the users want. Now we know that the people, the developers are using STMs, and they do get positive results from that. But now, how important is STMs then? So we had a third study. Once again, there's my research method, which I summarized there. I think you will be more interested in this. This is the success factors that we identified in the end, and we rank them. This is now the developers giving us feedback, not the users. The most important thing they felt that would influence the success of mobile apps is individual developer skills. They feel if you have a very good developer, your chance of success is very high. Functionality, mobile device specification issues, no surprise there. They want a software development kit. Backend, a lot of integration issues, backend integration, portability, web and network integration, and then software development methodology, second last. So once again, it's not that that they say it's not the critical success factor, but it's not the most important one. And then open source software technology on a scale from 1 to 5. That means 3 would be 1 to 5, the average of 3. Anything below 3 means it's not important. So open source technology wasn't important. But the nicest slide that I want to come to is this one. Where in my conclusion, where I compare what the users feel is necessary and the developers feel is necessary. And being a colorful person myself, I use color codes here to show what is happening. You will see when you look at the list of users, the factors, problems with the app is actually a quality issue. System development methodologies can address a quality issue. They also have user friendliness and they have ease of use as an issue. Once again, STMs can address these two. But if you look at the developers, they mentioned functionality. Functionality is directly influenced by the use of a STM. So it seems that STM does have a place. But what is important to me is if you look at the things that's the same, Users mentioned portability, the developers mentioned portability. Users mentioned this resource usage, developers mentioned mobile device specification issues. So there are things that we say, things are the same, but there are certain aspects that are totally different. The developers rated a lot of technical issues, which we can't expect the users to raise. But something that bothers me quite a bit is this security aspect here. It was fifth on the list, one, two, three, four, fifth on the list of important issues to the users, and it's not even mentioned by the developers. Don't they care about security? What is happening here? So there are some things here which bothers me. Like I said, advertisement, maybe we should think about branding and marketing. Clarity here is you should promise what you deliver. I didn't link that to system development methodologies because it's something, it's once again branding and marketing of your product. Security I spoke about, speed up tasks and productivity. This is a type of application they need. It's not an aspect of the mobile app they are talking about here. So I think what we did is by looking at the two groups, what the users want and what the developers think, we can see that each group has his or own has their preferences. There are some things missing. Like I said, I want to reiterate that security aspect really bothers me. And then before I'm in trouble, my last slide here. Just to conclude then, should we bother with SDMs? I say yes, we should. To conclude, traditional SDMs, agile SDMs, and to a lesser degree, mobile application SDMs are used to develop these mobile apps. And the SDMs are not used very strictly. Mobile applications developed with SDMs tend to be more successful than those developed without it. The strictness of SDM use has an impact on the success of mobile applications. And in order to improve the success of mobile applications, we should use SDMs more intensively, and developers should take note of the special needs of the mobile applications and of the mobile users. Sorry. And then that's our university. I should get that slide also near the end. So thanks for your attention. I'm happy to take questions then afterwards.